If you are joining us for the first time, let me give you just kind of some backdrop so that you can frame in all that we're going to discuss this morning. Our key text for the year and for the series is found in Matthew chapter 6, verse 33. And we're going to read this all together if we could this morning. These are the words of Jesus. He says, "Seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and he will give you everything you need." And in our first week, we looked at that verse and kind of dissected it in the original language and discovered that this word seek Jesus uses is the word zeteo in the Greek, and it means to discover by thinking, meditating, reasoning, and inquiring, to discover through inquiry and through meditation. And for the last 12 weeks, we have done just that. We have looked at the teachings of Jesus, and we have discovered what it means to be a kingdom person by inquiring of and meditating on the teachings of the Sermon on the Mount. And they are not some easy teachings. And there's been a lot of uncomfortable subject matter over the last 12 weeks, and talked about things like hatred for your enemies and rage and revenge and persecution. We talked about purity and money and possessions and forgiveness and divorce and a host of uncomfortable things to talk about at church, but a host of things that are really appropriate to talk about because it's where a lot of us are living and Jesus has something to say about it. If you've not been with us and any of those sound like they might be helpful, I encourage you to go back, check out podcasts and YouTube and all that stuff. But I also want to encourage you, even if you're just visiting today, but you live in the area, to come back next weekend as we continue on in that series, because we're going to be talking about what Jesus has to say regarding worry and anxiety and how we can find an antidote for it in him. How many think that would be helpful today? Okay. For those that do not raise your hands because you're worried and you're anxious, you don't want to raise your hand. I get it, but come back. It'll be good. But I think we could all benefit from a word about worry and anxiety. But today what we're going to do is we're going to take a brief detour from the Sermon on the Mount, and we're going to look at another portion of Scripture where Jesus uses this word, zeteo, to seek as he speaks to a woman by his empty grave. Our text for today, we're going to look at John chapter 20. If you have a Bible, you can turn there now. If not, this will pop up behind me on the screen. Hopefully, the screen has had demons this morning, so we're going to find out if it's still possessed or if it's working. But John chapter 20, verse 1 says this: "Early on Sunday morning, while it was still dark, Mary Magdalene came to the tomb and found that the stone had been rolled away from the entrance. She ran and found Simon Peter and the other disciple, the one whom Jesus loved, aka John, the guy who wrote this gospel. She said, 'They've taken the Lord's body out of the tomb. We don't know where they put him.' Peter and the other disciple started out for the tomb. They were both running, but the other disciple outran Peter and reached the tomb first. He stopped and looked in and saw the linen wrappings lying there, but he didn't go in. Then Simon Peter arrived and went inside. He also noticed the linen wrappings lying there, but where the cloth that had covered Jesus' head was folded up and lying apart from the other wrappings. Then the disciple who had reached the tomb first also went in, and he saw and believed, for until then they still hadn't understood the scriptures that said Jesus must rise from the dead. Then they went home." Now, pause here in the story for just a second. I need to point something out. It's not anything relevant to the sermon this morning, but it is a comical detail that I just really wanted to throw out there for consideration. You might have noticed that John felt it was necessary to include in his writings here twice that he outran Peter to the tomb. This is the pettiest thing any disciple has ever written in the New Testament. Not just once, but twice. Like, "Hey, I just thought you should know. Peter and I, we left at the same time. I mean, I got there first, but, we started running at this." And then just to kind of frame it in, he reminds us that he's the disciple that Jesus loves. It's like, come on, bro, your insecurity is showing. Like, seriously? I'm faster. I'm more loved than everybody. I think John was a middle child. Any middle children here? Exactly. You don't even want to raise your hand. You're right. You're like, it's hard. You got to prove yourself to, I don't know anything about it. I'm the firstborn. I already know I'm the favorite and I'm the best, but I mean, that's cool. It's whatever. But I was reading through some of the theological or the theologian's writings about this text. And I just found this quote comical. One guy said, "John was humble enough to avoid the mention of his own name, but competitive enough to remind us that he outran Peter to the tomb." Any petty competitive people here today? If you wrote a gospel, this is what you would include in there. Okay, 7 of us. Thank you. You're on my team, all right? We can compete together. But Mary ends up coming back to the tomb, and we read on in verse 11. It says, "Mary was standing outside the tomb crying, and as she wept, she stopped and looked in. She saw two white-robed angels, one sitting at the head and the other at the foot of the place where the body of Jesus had been lying. 'Dear woman, why are you crying?' the angels asked her. 'Because they've taken away my Lord,' she replied, 'and I don't know where they've put him.' She turned to leave and saw someone standing there. It was Jesus, but she didn't recognize him. "Dear woman, why are you crying?" Jesus asked her. And then here's our word. "Who are you seeking?" She thought he was the gardener. "Sir," she said, "if you've taken him away, tell me where you've put him and I will go and get him." "Mary," Jesus said. She turned to him and cried out, "Rabboni," which is Hebrew for teacher. This is such a beautiful conversation between Jesus and Mary Magdalene. A beautiful conversation, but I would also suggest a very applicable conversation. Applicable because I don't think Mary is the only person in history to ever have this kind of a chat with Jesus. In fact, I think as we go through our text today, what we're going to discover is that many, maybe in this room, are having a very similar conversation with the risen Christ today as well. And so to that end, let me offer you a title as we jump in. If this is your home church, you know how much I love to name sermons after songs, and today is no exception. I'm borrowing the chorus of the great lead singer of the rock band U2. These are the words of Bono, also Jesus. But he says this, "I still haven't found what I'm looking for." Come on, if you know it, sing it with me. "But I still haven't found." Okay, you guys are better than the 9 o'clock service. There's a bunch of lame, uneducated, cultural swine at the 9 o'clock, but you get it, all right? You're my people. Uncultured swine, not cultured swine. Let's pray. Holy Spirit, we come before you today and we ask that you'd speak to each and every one of us through these timeless words of Jesus today. As we look at this story of a woman by the side of a grave having a conversation with the risen King, I pray that we would be able to place ourselves in this story, see our own lives in light of this text. And God, as we go to the word, we open up our hearts to receive from you today. We did not come to go through the motions and sing some songs on a screen and leave the same way we came. We showed up here today because we believe that your word and your presence have the power to transform us. So move among us today. May these not be my words, may they be yours, speaking to every heart in Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen, amen. So I'm gonna take this jacket off. Is that okay with anybody? You guys are all doing this. I'm just like, sorry, if my sleeves are wrinkled, I'm gonna be like Bono, okay? Yeah. There you go. It's my kid down there. So I think the best place to start here this morning as we unpack this story and then subsequently begin to apply it to our lives is kind of with the main character, this woman, Mary, who actually became the first person in all of history to both witness and testify to the risen Savior. She is, in fact, the first preacher of the gospel in the New Testament. Don't tell me women can't preach, all right? This woman right here was a preacher of the gospel. She testified of the risen Lord to the disciples. Now we know in both Mark's gospel and Luke's gospel that Mary was one of the disciples who responded to the kingdom message of Jesus that we've been studying for the last 12 weeks. Luke chapter 8 says that Jesus went about preaching the good news of the kingdom from town to town and that many people became his disciples and followed him. And among them were some prominent women in the society who actually began to financially underwrite the ministry of Jesus. And Mary Magdalene was one of the women who gave of her own resources to support Christ. So it could be said that she was kind of the first holy sugar mama in all of scripture, but that's probably inappropriate. However, if you are a single rich woman here today and you'd like to support a ministry, I just offer up the Father's house to you. It's a great space. But in addition to this financial support that we see in the text, we are also told that Mary had a little bit of a past, that she was a bit of a hot mess before she came to Jesus. I can't speak for you. I'll speak for myself. I was a bit of a hot mess before I came. In fact, I can speak for some of you because I know your stories. You were a hot mess before you came to Jesus. I remember the day I met you on the porch and you were a mess. And you're in good company because Mary wasn't just a mess. It says that Jesus actually had to cast 7 demons out of her before she became a follower. I've never done that to anybody who showed up here for the first time. So she was a bit of a wreck before she came to Christ. Now, what is not clear in the scriptures, but is speculated among some of the theologians, is that this Mary Magdalene was also the same as the Mary of Bethany that we read about in the scriptures. Mary of Bethany, if you're unfamiliar, she was this immoral woman in the city of Capernaum that one day when Jesus was having dinner with a Pharisee and his disciples. She breaks into this dinner scene and she ends up pouring out a very expensive vial of perfume worth 1 year's wages on the feet of Jesus and begins to worship him, much to the criticism of the disciples in the room. And some believe that Mary Magdalene and Mary Bethany are the same. But whether or not they are the same, the fact remains, Mary Magdalene was a woman who radically encountered the grace of Jesus Christ. This was a woman whose past, a woman whose present vexed state encountered the King above all kings, the one who left his throne in heaven to walk among humanity. And in a moment, her entire life was transformed. In a moment, she met freedom and joy and purpose. When everybody else dishonored her, this man honored her and he invited her to become one of his disciples. And her life was so radically transformed that she left her city, followed him for 3 years as a disciple, and financially supported his ministry. He flipped her life upside down. But now, fast forward, this same woman who has encountered the life of Jesus finds herself at the side of his grave, confused, saddened, dismayed, because the man who transformed her life appears to be both dead and missing. No one can find him. But it is here in this hopeless state that Mary is asked a couple of questions. Questions that ultimately lead to her discovering what she was looking for all along. Questions that take her from a place of despair to delight. And in our remaining moments this morning, what I'd like to do is I want to consider the questions, because I believe that those same questions possess the power to do for us what they did for her. To bring those in the room who find themselves in a season of despair to delight, and to reveal that the one you're looking for might actually be standing right in front of you today. So let's consider these questions. The first of them is a question that is asked both by some angels and by Jesus. As Mary shows up to the grave, she is asked, "Why are you weeping? Why are you weeping?" She shows up the second time, peeks her head in, doesn't see anybody in the grave except for a couple of angels, and the angels turn to her and they say, "Dear woman, why are you weeping?" And then as she turns to leave and runs into the gardener, he asks the same question, "Hey, why are you weeping?" Now that, honestly, if we kind of step back from the text for a moment, that seems like a really unnecessary question with a pretty obvious answer. In fact, considering the context, it might even sound like a really insensitive question. I mean, think about this. Imagine you walked up to somebody who is standing by the graveside of a recently deceased loved one and they're weeping. You probably wouldn't ask them why. Why are you crying? What's the matter? Like, no, that's a really insensitive question. And yet, this is the question that is posed to Mary. Why are you weeping? Obviously, she's weeping because she's lost the man who changed her life. But perhaps there's even a deeper reason that Mary finds herself in this state of weeping, something that we may not see on the surface that goes far beyond just losing a loved one. Let's remember again who she was before she came to Christ. I remember how radically this woman met with Jesus. She was demonized. She was dishonored. She was forgotten and discredited by her society. And if some commentators are accurate, she was abused sexually by the men in her city. But then one day, she met Jesus. One day in her broken and frail state, Jesus walked right up to her and said, "I see something different than everybody else sees. I see past your state. I see past your sin. I see past your broken exterior. I see to the heart of the individual, and I see a woman who is worthy of honor. I see a woman who is worthy of dignity. I see a woman that I have a plan for and that I can use in my ministry." Come on, this is some of your story in the room today. Jesus did not see your sin. He did not see your brokenness. He saw past it, and he didn't just deliver her. He made her a prominent place among the disciples. He said, "Not only will you be my follower, you don't know this yet, but you're going to be the first person to see me resurrected, and you're going to declare my goodness to my other disciples." And then after encountering him for the better part of 3 years, this woman who had nothing to live for suddenly has divine purpose. She has this renewed sense of existence, and I know why I'm on the planet. I mean, can you just imagine a woman with that kind of history following Jesus every day, a new exciting part of the journey every day, a new sense of purpose and calling. But then all of it gets stripped away. In a moment, she witnesses the one who changed her life die on a cross, get set aside in a grave, and then when she shows back up, he's gone. I would imagine there's something inside of her that feels like it's not just he that died, but a piece of her died as well. Her purpose, her destiny, her future, buried in that same grave. Perhaps she would say, as the prophet Jeremiah did in Lamentations chapter 3, I am suffering because everything that I was hoping for seems to be lost. And I know that we're all dressed in pastels today, and we got smiles on, and we look our best on a Sunday morning. I saw your kids walk in there. They look great. They've never looked that great on any other Sunday of the year. I see them walk up. They got sleep in their eyes. Their hair's all sideways, barely wearing a shirt. Today, they're all put together. I know how we come to church on Easter, right? But maybe behind the sundresses and the pastels and the smiles, maybe there's some people in the room that would resonate with Mary's reality today. Some people that find themselves suffering and weeping beneath the surface as a result of some things that you were hoping for, but seem like they're lost. As a result of some news you've gotten recently or some things that feel like they've died in your life. I can say there seems to be an inordinate number of people in our church right now that find themselves in a suffering season. And I know a big church, there's always gonna be someone going through it, and that's normal. But man, it really does feel, especially over the last month, like the attack of the enemy has been coming in increased measure. That the enemy has been doing everything he possibly can to steal and kill and destroy, as his job description suggests, the people of the Father's house. Don't let that freak you out if you're looking to join the church. I'm just, you know, if you follow Jesus, it's gonna happen, all right? It's warfare. But man, I feel like I just hear so many stories lately. Even in the last couple of weeks, two members of our worship team found out that multiple family members of theirs passed away unexpectedly, mothers and brothers and sisters. So many that have gotten terminal diagnosis with no cure. Literally last Sunday, I'm standing out on the porch there after the 9 a.m. and the 11 a.m. service, and two separate guys come up to me at two separate times and tell me that during the service, their mom had to go to the ER and they don't know why, that things didn't look great. We're here Friday doing a rehearsal for today, and find out that another one of our worship team members had to rush his wife to the emergency room that night. And then Rocky, our maintenance guy out there, literally lost his mom 10 minutes before we started church today. His mom passed away. Some of you know that our youth pastor, Dylan Baker, that's an old one, Drew Baker, I know his name. He was in the hospital last week for a bacterial infection in his heart that was really serious. And man, you add to that the people that are facing separation and divorce and infertility and unemployment. It feels like everywhere I turn lately, there's somebody else suffering, weeping, walking through a challenging season. But you know what else I've witnessed in the Father's house? In the midst of suffering, you know what else I've witnessed? I've witnessed great faith. I've witnessed some people that have tapped into a secret that has served as an anchor for their troubled soul and has allowed them to continue to worship even in the midst of their weeping. Some people that discovered what Mary discovered 2,000 years ago as she found herself next to an empty grave. The reality that even in the midst of weeping and even in the midst of suffering, you do not serve a God that stands afar off with his arms folded and watches as you walk through the valley, but you serve a God that is with you in the midst of your suffering. Mary didn't see it at first. She thought she was talking to the gardener, but it was Jesus standing with her while she wept. As he was promised in his birth, now he proves even at his resurrection, he is Emmanuel, the God that is with you and with her, the God that never leaves you or forsakes you. Let me just declare over you today, if you are walking through a trying season, if you are weeping and you are suffering, God is not standing back waiting till you got a smile before he shows up. He's with you in the valley. He's with you in the suffering. He's not gonna leave you or forsake you there. He will walk you through it. Even as we said in a sermon on suffering just a couple of weeks ago, the same God that sees you in it is the God that will see you through it. And listen, I don't say that today to like minimize what you're walking through or suggest, okay, hurry up and get it over with it because, you know, God's with, that's not what I'm saying. The Bible is clear. There are chapters and seasons to this life. There is a time to weep. There is a time to mourn. But may this story of a weeping woman in a garden remind you, suffering is a temporary season and not a permanent destination. Yes, you may suffer, but as the psalmist said in chapter 30, verse 5, the weeping may last through the night. There is a joy that comes in the morning. And the promise of Easter morning today is that whether you're walking through the darkest season of your life or you're on a mountaintop, joy is coming. There is good ahead for those who know the Lord. That's the promise. And Mary's about to discover some great joy. But before she does, she needs to answer a second question. A question that Jesus poses to her after he asks her why she's weeping. Having been asked that, he then turns to Mary and he says, "Who are you seeking? Why are you weeping? Who are you seeking?" Now, again, this seems to be an unnecessary question with an obvious answer. She's seeking you, Jesus. That's why she's here. Like, you should know that. You're omniscient. Why would you ask? But I want to suggest for a couple moments that what looks like an unnecessary question with an obvious answer is actually a question within a question. It's a question inception, if you will. There's something deeper happening beneath the surface here. And we know that because Jesus is not the only one to ask Mary this question. In fact, he isn't even the first one to ask Mary this question. This question was actually posed to her by some angels on her first trip to the grave. Although John does not include these details in his gospel, look at what Luke says in his gospel, chapter 24. "But very early on Sunday morning, the women went to the tomb, taking the spices they had prepared. They found that the stone had been rolled away from the entrance, so they went in, but they didn't find the body of the Lord Jesus. As they stood there puzzled, two men suddenly appeared to them, clothed in dazzling robes. The women were terrified and bowed with their faces to the ground. Then the men asked, 'Why do you seek the living among the dead? He isn't here. He is risen from the dead. Remember what he told you back in Galilee, that the Son of Man must be betrayed into the hands of sinful men and be crucified, and that he would rise again on the third day.' Then they remembered that he had said this. So they rushed back from the tomb to tell his 11 disciples and everyone else what had happened. It was Mary Magdalene and several other women who told the apostles what had happened." So Luke records some details that John didn't include. John was too busy talking about how fast he was and how loved he was, and so he didn't say. But Luke, he was a bit more of a comprehensive gospel here. And Luke tells us that when Mary showed up to the tomb the first time, she was told in no uncertain terms that Jesus was alive, that he had resurrected from the grave. They said, "Why are you seeking for the living among the dead? He is not here. He is risen, just as he said." And having heard this news, Mary and the other woman go back, tell the disciples. John, Peter, bounce, they run to the tomb. John gets there first. And Mary follows a second time. Now, I find that odd. I find it odd that Mary would go back to the tomb because she's already been told that Jesus is not there. She's been given a direct statement from angels, from heaven. It's not like it was hearsay and she had to kind of check it. She talked to an angel and the angel said, "He is not here." So why would you go back to a graveyard to find someone who is alive? To borrow the language of the angels, why would you search for the living among the dead? Answer: because that's what you do when you haven't found what you're looking for. Mary had heard, but she hadn't found the Savior yet. And when you haven't found what you're looking for, you tend to look for life in dead places. And people do it all the time. In fact, maybe some are doing it here today. I provide a couple of examples. Many people look for life in some of the dead things we talked about last week and in our series: money and possessions. They think, if I can just get a little bit more, if I can stash away a little bit more, if I've got this saved, if I could have this kind of a retirement, then I will be satisfied. I'll kick back and I'll enjoy my life. But it's amazing that when you get what you thought you were looking for, it doesn't satisfy the way you thought it would. You still find yourself wanting. Some look for life in status or achievements, other dead things. If I could just get to that title or that promotion, or if I could just get to that level or that status, then I'll be satisfied. Then I'll kick back and I'll enjoy life then on, only to find that when you get there, it doesn't satisfy. It at best provides a bit of temporary satisfaction, but once the high wears off, you're back on the grind looking for life, the next achievement, the next title. Some look for life in companionship, relationships. If I just had a man, I would be happy. They usually sit in this section. Every time I make a joke like that, they all woo over here. It's weird. I don't know. No offense to anyone sitting in that section. But I'm not going to say that there's no satisfaction in relationships. Yes, there is a certain degree of satisfaction when you find the person you're supposed to spend the rest of your life with. But ironically, a soulmate does not satisfy the soul. The until death do us part, it can be a dead place if you're waiting for it to bring true life. No offense to my bride in the front row. I love you. You satisfy me. But I just have more needs that only Jesus can satisfy. And even people doing what we're doing right now, many people look for life in religion. Millions of people will go to church for the first and last time today because it's Easter all year long. And sorry, I'm not going to make any eye contact when I say that. Because they bought into the lie that a religion about God, void of a relationship with God, is going to provide them some sense of meaning and life. But man, then they hang up the pastels at the end of the day. They still don't feel like they've found what they're looking for. And on and on and on it goes. Humanity is searching for life in a whole lot of dead places as they sing the familiar chorus, I still haven't found what I'm looking for. They're looking for the right thing, wrong place. And so perhaps now is the best time to do what I so love to do every single weekend here at the Father's house. If you're new, every week, I do my best to pose a question to force everyone to personalize what we're talking about, lest we think we're talking about somebody else or the guy in the back row, but not you. I'm talking about you right now. So let me pose a personal question to every person in the room today. Have you found what you're looking for? Honestly, in your search for satisfaction, are you satisfied? As you pursue peace, do you have it yet? Are you free? Do you have true joy that is not circumstantial, but something that sustains even in the darkest of seasons? Do you have purpose? Do you have meaning? Is there something more than the grind to live for? Have you found what you're looking for? And if not, let me tell you why I think God brought you to church today. You may think you got invited by somebody else or drugged by somebody else. You may think it was the bus ad on the back of Muni that drew you here, or maybe it was the Instagram post you saw, or maybe you Googled what church was closest to your house or your Muni stop, and that's how you got it. Let me tell you the real reason you're here today. You're not here because somebody invited you. You're not here because you just stumbled upon an ad or you saw something on the back of a bus. You're here because the Holy Spirit brought you to the house today. You're here because God has your number. God drew you to his house because he wants to flip some things upside down in your life today. And you are here because God wants to do for you what he did for Mary in a garden 2,000 years ago. He wants to take you from a place of despair to delight and once and for all put an end to your search in the things of this life to hopefully find meaning and substance and joy. He wants to do what he did for Mary. After asking the questions and not finding what she was looking for, Jesus did something to snap her out of her seeking state and once and for all reveal that the one she was looking for was standing right in front of her. You know what he did? He called her by name. He said, Mary!
Mary! Exclamation point. Mare Bear.
Maria, Maria.
Soy yo, Jesus, Cristo, not the gardener, it's me. Don't you see who's standing in front of you? You're looking for life in a grave, but you will not find life in a dead place. Stop looking for the living among the dead. I'm standing right in front of you. The life I gave to you before, I am offering once again. It's not dead because you saw me die on a cross. I have resurrected on the third day like I promised. And that life I gave to you is just as available now as it was back then. The life you're looking for, the thing you're looking for, it's right in front of you. And the Bible says that when Mary heard her name, she responded back and said, Rabboni, which means teacher in Hebrew. In other words, when she heard her name, she called upon his name. May that be the story of every seeking soul and every church across San Francisco and this nation and the globe today, that people would hear Jesus call their name, and in response, they would call upon the name of the Savior. May you have a Romans 10:9 moment this morning. Confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord. Believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, and may you find life. And listen, if that's you today, if you find yourself at a distance from God and you hear him calling your name, in just a moment, we will pray and I'll invite you to pray along with me and make that decision to follow him. But before I do, there remains a caveat I need to speak to for just a moment. An asterisk to this whole conversation, lest I overpromise and underdeliver on this life that God has made available to each and every one of us. So let me hit the elephant-sized fine print in the room for just a moment, if I could. I know that there are people sitting in the room right now that would say, hey, Tim, I've done what you're talking about. I have committed my life to Jesus. I consider myself to be a follower. I've been coming to church and doing my best to pray and read the scriptures. And, you know, I'm doing the best I can. But if I'm honest, I still feel like there's some things lacking in my life. I still feel like maybe I haven't quite found everything that I'm looking for. And I can see you nodding your heads at me right now. And you want to believe what I'm saying. You're like, you sound believable. Your suit looked decent. Your ankles are stunning. Like, I just really want to believe you today. But I'm not feeling what you're talking about. And listen, I'm not going to presume to be able to address every single situation in the room and why that might be or might not be. In fact, I was talking to somebody after the first service and they're like asking a bunch of questions. I can't answer all the questions, but I can offer you one suggestion this morning. One reason that perhaps there are believers who still feel like they haven't found what they're looking for. A reason that we talk about every single Easter. If you're taking notes, you can write this down, but here's what I believe. We discover resurrection life through Jesus, but we experience resurrection life through baptism. Through baptism. Now, if this is your home church, you know that we talk about baptism a lot around here. Like, a lot. Like, probably too much. We sound pretty thirsty and desperate when it comes to baptism. Like, every single weekend, middle of worship, turn your attention to the screen, someone's gonna water baptize, and we hear the person's story, and then the person on the mic, they're like, if you've made a decision to follow Jesus and you've not been water baptized, we wanna invite you to take your next step. You can do it publicly or privately, or you can sign up on the app or on the website, and you should take your next step and get water baptized. And then at the end of the service, I pray, and then again, someone gets up and they're like, hey, we invite you to take your next step, and check the box and say, if you wanna get baptized, on the card. And then in verse 40, we do this discipleship program for 40 days, and then one of the weeks, it's like, hey, you need to get baptized, because baptism is really, like on and on and on and on and on it goes. We talk about it a lot around here. But there's a reason we're really, really passionate about baptism. And the reason we are really passionate about baptism is because we understand that it is entirely possible for Christians to still feel like they have not found what they're looking for until they step into the waters of baptism. And if that sounds like heresy or like I'm suggesting Jesus is not enough, that's not what I'm saying. But consider the scripture for just a moment. Romans chapter 6. The apostle Paul says, don't you know that all of us who were baptized into Christ Jesus, were baptized into his death. We were therefore buried with him through baptism into death in order that just as Christ was raised from the dead through the glory of the Father, we too may live a new, what? Life. For if we've been united with him in his death,
we will certainly also be united with him in a resurrection like his. That is probably the clearest scripture in the whole New Testament on the subject of baptism, and Paul makes it abundantly clear. The life you're looking for, the resurrection life, it is found in identifying with the death of Christ when you go down under those waters, and the resurrection of Christ as you come out in the waters of baptism. There is a life, a supernatural life. I can't explain it to you. I'm going to start doing the poem. Like, I wish I could describe it to you, but it's indescribable. There is a supernatural element that takes place in the waters of baptism where the old sin nature is put to death and a new man, a new woman resurrects in Christ. And I think that's why the enemy works overtime to keep people out of the waters. He whispers all kinds of lies to keep people from getting baptized. Some of you have heard them. Some of you are responding to them right now. Lies like, well, you're not ready yet. You got to clean up your life. You got to get rid of that sin. You got to get free first, and then you can qualify to get into the waters of baptism. All lies from the father of lies. Consider the absurdity of those statements in light of that scripture. You got to get rid of your sin first before you get into the waters of baptism. Well, Paul said that the old man doesn't die until he goes into the waters and that a new man resurrects. So if the enemy can keep you chasing your tail, trying to find freedom that you'll never find until you get into the waters, man, what a great ploy. No, the freedom you desire, the life you desire is on the other side of baptism, not something you achieve before you get into the waters. That's like saying get clean before you get into the bathtub. It just does not make any sense. And I'm not ready? That's the dumbest thing I ever heard. You're not ready for what? Freedom? For joy? For life? For abundance? For everything that Jesus has made available to you? Yeah, you're ready, honey. And so today we're going to dispel every lie, and we're going to make sure that every person in the room has an opportunity to find what they are looking for in Jesus. As is our custom, every single Easter, we have opened up a baptism tank in our atrium. And today, if you need to experience the life that is available in Jesus through baptism, you do not have to leave this place without getting dunked. Okay? Whether you're coming to Jesus today or you've been following for a while and you haven't gotten baptized yet, today is your day. Easter 2024, where you say, that is the day I found what I was looking for. And in just a moment, as we conclude, someone will come down here with a sign and they'll wave it, and you can come after the service and tell them that you'd like to get baptized, and we're going to all hang out there and party with you, and it's going to be awesome. But real quick, before we do that, I already know what's happening in some people's heads, all right? I know how you are, so I'm gonna talk about those things for just a second. Someone's thinking, well, like, I didn't come dressed for baptism today, which, by the way, would be really weird if you just showed up in a bathing suit to church. Robin's in her pajamas, you can show up in your bathing suit, it's great. But let me put you at ease. If you did not show up with a bathing suit today, good news, we have clothes for you. We have kits with shirts and shorts, and I was told bras and underwear. And Jess just told me before the service, leggings for the women that didn't shave their legs. We've got everything inside these kits so that you can get water baptized and then change back into your clothes and you can head out from here, all right? We've thought of everything. I've heard this excuse as well. I just got my hair did, so I don't want to get in there because my hair is did. First of all, really? What? Okay. But secondly, Jazzy, our kids pastor and baptism director, who is very hair conscious, she has gotten little caps that are satin lined for if you just got your hair did. So you can still get in the water even if your hair's did. It'll stay did afterward. It'll be awesome. And maybe you're like, well, I want my friends and my family members to see it and they're not here today. Fear thee not. We got videographers. We got photographers. We'll get your email. We'll get your phone number. We'll send you all the information so that you can share it with your loved ones. There is no excuse to not experience the freedom that Jesus has made available for you today. But even if all that sales pitch didn't work, I have an ace up my sleeve today. Every week, we get an opportunity to celebrate with someone as they get water baptized and hear their story. So if you don't believe me, turn your attention to the screen. Let's check out Larry's story and see what he has to say about it.
My name is Lawrence Dolan, and this is my story. My life before I met Jesus was chaos. I was a troubled young man. in school growing up, like they'd have parent-teacher conferences with a police officer in fourth grade, and I thought like that was normal. I was very rebellious. I liked doing the wrong thing. I liked stealing. I liked running from the principal. I liked running from the cops. Like I got a rush from it. That was before drugs and alcohol. You know, once I found drugs and alcohol, I took off running. It got pretty ugly fast. Years in jail, I had to go to prison. Drug dealing, criminal, I guess you could say, when deep down all I really was scared. And so this one particular time I got out, did a shot of heroin and I overdosed. And luckily there was a man there who knew enough about mouth to mouth and oxygen to the brain. He gave me oxygen to the brain. He gave me mouth to mouth till the ambulance got there. And then they took me to the hospital. They gave me a shot and they revived me. And I woke up in the hospital bed and my first thought was, okay, I'm not cuffed. My second thought was, how can I go get loaded? This drug literally took my life and I wanted to go do it again. That's the insanity of this disease. It was a revolving door for me going to jail. And then it was like, I'd get out of jail. And it's like half the time I'd run from probation or parole and catch me if you can. I'd go back into jail and it was just a vicious cycle. I remember crying, you know, telling my mother like behind the glass, like, Mom, I don't want to live this life anymore. As selfish and self-centered I was in my disease, I still knew I was killing the people who cared about me and supported me, you know? What happened there by telling my mom that is I knew I was hurting other people, not just myself. I got out of a rehab and I walked into a 7-Eleven. This is a true story. And Stefan, I've been to jail with for years. I ran with him. He's my best friend, like Ryan. And I saw him in the 7-Eleven and he had pep in his step. And I looked at him, I'll never forget it. It's a true story. I go, bro, what are you doing? And he looked at me and he's like, well, I found God. And I said, no, bro. He was going to these meetings and he was sharing his testimony on how God changed his life and he's not a heroin addict anymore. And I wanted it. I was attracted to it. Out of nowhere, I had this willingness and I know it was God. I know it was Jesus. And there was another time, long story short, my Aunt Kathy, she's a Christian woman and she believes in Jesus. She got on the phone with me and she prayed. Jesus, rescue him from his addiction. Bring him into the light. She kept saying Jesus Christ. She kept saying Jesus. I was crying on the phone with her and I said, please, please. Jesus answered those prayers, man. He lifted the obsession to use, and that is the core of my faith today. I looked myself in the eye and I was just like, dude, I don't want to use anymore. I was so happy, and not only did I not want to use anymore, I started feeling the love of God. I started feeling strength. So I started praying to God, God, you know, what is this I'm feeling? Help me. What is this love I'm feeling? And he started guiding me over the years. And today I sit here at over 10 years sober and it's all glory goes to him. He removed a disease, heroin addiction, and a life of chaos from me. And he brought me to this very moment. How was Ryan involved in my process coming to Christ? How much time you guys got? Once he started going to the Father's house and once he started having a relationship with Jesus and he got baptized, I seen a shift in him. Like the confidence and the love. And here's an important word, the peace he has. And he's an inspiration. And he inspired me to get to go to the Father's house. And he inspired me, to get baptized. By going into those waters today, it's a declaration of my faith. I trust them. My life is beautiful now. I mean, there's highs and lows. I have to feel everything like other humans, but I know how to deal with it. I give my insecurities and my defects to God. I give them to Jesus. I rely on him for strength. It's like an ace up my sleeve. I want to serve God. I want to serve this church. We sit down there, right there on this couch. We have a Bible study right in this room. I love other people today. I care about other people. I have purpose today. And I want to glorify him and give him all credit and have him mold me into what he wants me to be. Today with my baptism, I'm finding new life in Jesus Christ and I'm pumped.
Because of your declaration of faith, Larry, I now baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
I think Larry's in here. Are you in here? Come on, Larry. Stand up to your feet. I love you, bro. So what's cool is 2 years ago, Ryan, the guy sitting next to him, was our Easter story, and we filmed him getting baptized in those disgustingly cold waters that you guys keep making me get into. And now 2 years later to see your best friend take that next step in water baptism. I love how God writes stories from one to another and another one and another one and another one. So beautiful. Larry ended his story by saying, today I'm finding my new life in Jesus. If you need to experience that today, let's pray. Let's invite that new life to come and meet you where you're at. Why don't you bow your heads and close your eyes? I won't belabor this, but if you're here this morning and you say, I'm away from God, I sense him calling my name, as you said a moment ago. I know I need to get things right with Jesus and step into this relationship with him. I want to pray a very simple prayer of commitment with you. But as we do, if you need to be included in this today, would you just simply shoot up your hand and look at me and say, Tim, that's me. I need to give my life to Jesus today. No one's looking around. Got you, bro. Yeah, both you guys over here. Awesome. Yeah, right here, ma'am. Thank you. Yeah, I got you right here. Cool. Over the back. Up there. Yes. 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 Yes, right here. Awesome. Right there. Yeah. Hallelujah. Yeah, up in the rafters. Very cool. A lot of people coming to Jesus. Got you, bro, on the end. Yeah. Oh, I love this. Here's what we're going to do. All of us are going to pray with you today so that you don't feel alone in saying this prayer. So everyone repeat after me. Just say, Jesus, today I give you my life. I thank you for giving yours for mine. I choose to follow you, to be your disciple, and walk in your ways. Forgive me of my sin and help me to follow you from this day forward until I see you in eternity. In the name of Jesus. Come on, amen, 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 amen. Come on, lift one more shot. That was a heck of people coming to Jesus today.